So the time having arrived, I call this meeting of the Brockton School Committee to order and ask you to please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. We usually open up our meetings with hearing of visitors. That's an opportunity for residents to come forward and speak directly to the superintendent and myself and the school committee. However, tonight no one signed up to speak. So we will move right along to the consent agenda. The consent agenda is the manner in which the school committee handles routine pieces of business as one block in order to expedite the meeting. However, prior to considering the consent agenda, we offer the members of the committee, any member who would like to remove any individual item from the consent agenda for individual consideration, please let me know. Mr. Minichiello.
Item B, approval of Bernard Risley scholarship donation.
Okie doke. Item B. Anyone else? Okay, then I'll entertain a motion on the consent agenda minus item B.
So moved.
Motion has been properly made and seconded. All in favor? Approved unanimously. Mr. Minichiello on item B.
Well, when reviewing our packet, item B jumped out at me because A, it is a very generous scholarship, the Bernard Risley Aerospace Engineering and Technical Scholarship. And B, it's certainly an area that I would have never qualified for because you need engineering and technical skill. This is very unique. Candidate must be graduating from Brockton High School and accepted at either a two-year technical program training for aircraft engineer repair and maintenance or a four-year college or university with a declared major of mechanical, aerospace, or electrical engineering. Scholarship to be awarded based on need and merit. I think that obviously is a very generous $4,000 annual scholarship until the funds are exhausted. We certainly appreciate that, and I'm sure that there will be some students that can certainly benefit from what I would consider a very substantial scholarship and donation to the district. So we very much appreciate that generosity from the organizers of this scholarship. So I would thank them publicly.
Again, when you look at it, is it Mr. Risley was a 1936 graduate of Brockton High School, and you know was very proud of his alma mater. You know, to give back to students is something, when we even talk about our development office, is something we'd like to encourage of a number of our alumni. We've had very successful alumni along the way, and to continue to support the school helps a student, again, looking to advance their education and one-day career. So we're very, very pleased to have that. The money was put into our Brockton Education Foundation, and the amount of money will be able to support that scholarship for many years to come for our students.
That's great.
Wonderful.
So, how about a motion?
Motion to approve the scholarship.
Second.
Seconded. Motion made and seconded. All in favor? Approved. That'll bring us on to the report of the superintendent of schools.
It seems impossible that it's really just a little over the second week of school, and it feels like we've been here forever. But it was very exciting. The first thing I want to talk about was Monday were our little kindergartners coming to the Brockton Public Schools, many of them for the first time. I know my staff was out there. I had the opportunity. It was a regularly scheduled visit. I had told you my commitment is in the morning. During the weeks, I have regularly scheduled visits in all of the schools. So I happened to be at the Huntington School on the opening of kindergarten. I was amazed that after the students were brought in, they were immediately brought to their classes. Our executive director and principal, June Saba-McGuire, brought the parents down to their cafeteria to go over what life would be like in the Brockton Public Schools and the Huntington School. By the time we actually, and I think behind us are all of the schools with pictures that Jocelyn Meek took of our little kindergartners coming, but I was amazed in getting up to the classroom, they were already working. I got to sing ABCs, it was great. We got to ask some questions. The children were sitting at their desks. They were working. You would think that they knew exactly what they were doing on their first day. Now, I haven't talked to any of you about what had happened the second day, but yesterday was a success in the district. I think our Deputy Superintendent, Liz Barry, has a report to share with us about the numbers. I know that's something that we're very much interested in, and I will caution you that even though it's the first week of kindergarten, we continue to enroll youngsters. We do have parents that, whether they're just new to our district, we're still actually placing students in our kindergarten classes.
As far as the numbers go, yesterday we had 1,595 of brand new students in Brockton, our preschool students as well as our kindergartners. 1,347 were kindergarten students who attended the first day of school. And 248 children are new to the preschool program at the Gilmore School. Enrollment at the Barrett-Russell is at 179, and last year we were at 192 on the first day of school, just to give you some context with that. There are currently 70 kindergarten incomplete files. We're waiting on some information from parents to complete those files as well. Once those files have been completed, those students will be enrolled at the Barrett-Russell. This tends to be a very busy month for us enrollment-wise, and so I fully suspect that the numbers that we're talking about today will increase in the next month or so, which they have done in the past, particularly at this early level. So those are our numbers as they stand the first day of school.
And I want to remind everybody that one of the things that we find is when we go through the kindergarten process, parents tend to choose the school that siblings go to, school closest to where the child lives. So very quickly, some of our numbers, when I look at a number of our schools, for instance, the Arnone has kindergarten classes of 25 and 26. The Angelo, a little better, but I have a 23 and a 24. The Brookfield, our numbers are just where I want them, at 2021, which is where we would want kindergarten classes. So we have some schools that we don't have a lot of area for growth. Barrett-Russell, again, I can't say that it's the first school chosen, but you're seeing that attitude change with parents. They were very pleased. Last night I was at the Hancock School PTA meeting and or PAC meeting, and one of the things a parent was talking to me about was how she was upset last year that her child didn't get into the Hancock for kindergarten, went to the Barrett-Russell, and how much that once the seat opened up, she wouldn't change. She loved what was happening at the Barrett-Russell. It was truly a kindergarten center. So again, it's kind of the best of both worlds, but we are seeing parents select the schools that siblings are going to for grades 1 through 5, or that may be closer to their home. I think you'll see that attitude start to change as we go forward. So the Barrett-Russell, for students that are coming in now, is where we will place the students, and next year they will obviously be able to choose a school of their choice for first grade.
Questions?
The lights up. Can we have the lights up, please? Yeah. This is getting a little difficult.
It's a little disturbing.
I'm sorry, we're struggling with it.
Our eyes.
Yeah. I'll move for the next presentation. It's just difficult.
There we go.
Okay. Questions?
I need to shut the projector.
Any questions for the superintendent on today's first day of kindergarten? Yesterday's first day of kindergarten, excuse me.
Okay, very good. On our budget update, FY 2015, we do have a finance subcommittee meeting coming up very soon. I say that because I'm working, again, very closely with our budget officer to, as we get closer now to the opening of school, our school is open. What we want to do at this time is to take a look at pockets throughout the district of some of our needs. It could be a paraprofessional that we've identified for a special needs class. It could be, as we look at space, which is an issue for us, it could be additional teachers needed in some of our elementary classes. So we're looking at
monies that we have put aside for this very need, as we've done every school year. So we'll start to identify our needs of the district. We're also going to be looking at, again, some of our, we have administrative assistants, we have custodians, we have our parent liaisons. So at that meeting, we'll start to identify using some of those funds for what we consider possibly priority needs at this time. And we'll also be able to identify, I keep saying that as we hire, teachers have left. We had an early retirement incentive. We are, you know, presently finishing up our hiring for the opening of school, and we'll be able to see if additional funds will realize during that time to support some of the programs that we have reduced in the district. I'm also looking forward, to tell you the truth, I'm looking forward to turning the page. So we start FY16. I had an excellent meeting just a little over a week ago. Jay Condon, our chief financial officer, myself, Aldo Petronio, and Chris Correa sat down, and I mentioned to the mayor at our meeting the other day, we went through Schedule 19. It made sense to me, whether I liked it or not. I understood the ratios. I understood the dollar-for-dollar amounts. And one of the things that I will assure you this year is when I sign on the dotted line as the superintendent, the mayor, of course, has to sign Schedule 19, we will know where every penny has gone. And certainly, I want to thank Jay Condon publicly for spending time, having some deep discussion about some areas that we might want to look at in a number. Some of it is ratios, some of it is dollar-for-dollars, but I certainly understand that. Also, I talked today to Mr. Petronio. We're going to be attending a workshop that's coming up, I think October 9th. It's on our Chapter 70 funding. They talk about looking at the year ahead, so when we have the retreat at the end of October, we'll already be obviously starting to talk about our FY16 budget, not in December, not in January. We'll start to talk about it now to prepare for next year.
Good.
Any questions, sir?
Any questions for the superintendent? Budget? Okay.
Okay. The next is certainly good news. And as things become more difficult in a budget, we're talking about grants, we're talking about development, we're talking about being out there, talking to businesses, talking to community organizations, and so many continue to support the students in the Brockton Public Schools. I will tell you that an organization that goes back, I know it was the early 90s, I know it was when we had, okay, 92, I see that date up there. It was during budget cuts similar to what we have now. I was a young parent in the district, a teacher in the district. I remember when Save Our Sports came about. And it was a group of concerned citizens. It was talking about athletics at the time, and how do we make sure that we don't have fees, that every student in our district has opportunities to take part in our competitive sports. And it's remained with us for many, many years. Save Our Sports, and I'm talking a little bit about their mission, is to support our students. It could be a bus trip, it could be uniforms, it could be equipment. There are ways that Save Our Sports, again, continues to support our students. But I will tell you that Gary Leonard, the president of Save Our Sports, came to myself, Mr. Minicello, I believe Deputy Superintendent Thomas was involved, sometime in late August, to talk to us about those things that were still not funded. We had a long conversation with Mr. Leonard. We actually went and presented to Save Our Sports, I want to say last Monday, I think it was the 8th of September, and what we presented to them was our intramurals at the high school, and we presented to them our intramurals at the elementary school that we were looking to support that presently had been eliminated in our budget. So I would like to invite Gary Leonard to come up here, please, if he could take the microphone. I want him to share the good news about what Save Our Sports will be doing to support our students for this year.
Thank you, Superintendent. It's a little past my bedtime, so if I nod off, just throw that cold water on me, if you would. Save Our Sports' inception was in 1992. Their main mission at that time was to raise funds in order for the children and the kids of Brockton not have to pay to play sports. Since the inception, we have never bowed to that problem, so we've been very lucky. What Save Our Sports have done in the past, we fertilized the fields, we've seeded the fields, we put down gymnasium floors, scoreboards, equipment, uniforms, you name it, anything to deter the athletic department from having to charge the kids in order to play sports. It'd be an awful thing. Nobody says it better than my good friend Tom Minichiello talk about his kids. It'd be awful funny for a 5'4" to be the center of a basketball team. These kids all should have the opportunity to go on to higher education. That's why Save Our Sports in the last 14, 15 years have put out a program. We put a pre-SAT review course, and we just received a grant from the Van Otterloo Foundation for $25,000. So therefore, now we're running two courses a year. And it being so big that we're inviting all students at this time. So it's not just for student athletes, it's for all concerned. I just want to say a little bit about the superintendent. Her and her husband, Jerry, have supported Save Our Sports ever since I've been part of it, and I've been part of it for some 22 years. They've always come through for us, so when I felt and I saw there was a little problem with the budget this year, I just wanted them to let them know that we are always here to assist. That's what we're all about. None of us on our committee have any children in the school system whatsoever. We do it for the love of the boxers, and that's what we're all about. And I want to thank you all for this opportunity just to give you a little insight on what we're all about. And again, thank you for the opportunity.
Gary, and I have to tell you, when we went to the meeting on September 8th, I looked at Bobby Bonnet, who's been there certainly since 1992, and we started to talk about, and probably a lot of you will remember, one of the first things they did was they had a carnival. And I remember bringing my kids, it was great, we did spaghetti dinners, and I was surprised when Bobby told me he was ready to do the carnival again. But that's not too far from what we probably need. So I want to thank, tonight we have John Booten, coach, who we coached way back. I'm so proud I was coach of the cheerleaders. And you were so good to our girls, such a gentleman. And thank you again. I know you do a lot of good work with Save Our Sports. Certainly Gary. And again, I mentioned Bobby and Tom Kenny. So again, Tom Kenny is in the audience. People never go away. This is great about the Brockton Public Schools. You know, you might leave, but we always get you back in some fashion. And just to share with you, they're going to be funding our three-day-a-week program at Brockton High School for intramurals for $13,200. An average daily attendance we're looking at of about 60 students, our free weight room, our Nautilus room, our cardio room, and a volleyball and table tennis activity. And I know you're going to be coming and seeing a lot of the participation and what is exactly happening. We also are going to bring back for 3 days a week from October to May our elementary intramural program at 12 schools. The activities range from basketball, volleyball, dodgeball, flag football, soccer. That cost was $35,700, and we're going to be splitting that. Save Our Sports, I believe, will fund about $17,000. We actually have some additional money in our revolving account for our sports, our athletic department, and they will fund the other $17,000. So we're pleased for this year to be able to offer that at a time when so many of the programs were cut. So again, thank you very much for being good community members and for all the hard work you do. And again, Bobby, I'm right there with you if we do that carnival. Thank you. Oh, yeah.
I would also just like to add my personal thanks. I've been around boxer sports for a long time too, and know how much work, great work Save Our Sports does. I think in my 17 years of calling games, I worked with four different athletic directors, and Mr. Booten and Mr. Kenny are two of them. And it's they just do a tremendous job supporting Brockton student athletes, and they always emphasize the student part first. And you mentioned the weight room, Gary, and that was one of the great projects that Save Our Sports did over the years, was that weight room. And by funding that intramural program, that allows some of our out-of-season student athletes to be able to come in and do some conditioning on their own after school. So it's I'm just very appreciative also, and as great as the weight room is, the SAT prep class is probably, in my mind, the best thing Save Our Sports does over the years, because the majority of our athletes don't get to continue to compete at the college level, but our goal is always to get all of our athletes into college, and I think that SAT class really makes it clear as to what our priorities are with our student athletes. So thank you so much for helping us out during this very difficult budget year. Anyone else like to be recognized? Mr. Minicello?
I guess this goes under a suspension of the rules.
Okay.
I'd just like to say how this organization has consistently been a great friend to the Brockton Public Schools and to the city of Brockton. And this is a huge investment, you know, some $30,000 combined that this organization is so generously donating to our students. Their philosophy, I think, is what we all work for and why we're basically in this business or arena. And, you know, they do it out of the goodness of their heart. They volunteer. They don't get paid. This is what, you know, being a good citizen is all about, and this is why they are Brocktonians through and through. So again, thank you very much. I know that you always support our students, and it was clear at that meeting with the questions, the comments. There's, you know, a great concern and a commitment to our young people of this school system, and your efforts are greatly appreciated, and your, you know, reputation in the city is just, you know, second to none.
And I think I want to say finally, your meetings are the first Monday?
First Monday of every month at the great cafeteria at Brockton High School.
So first Monday of every month at 6:30 in the Red Cafeteria at Brockton High School. And one of the things I hope you did hear is the members that are there, not one of them have children that are participating in sports. So we'd like to get word out there, those parents that are listening in the audience, watching, you know, if you want to get involved, we need you. So, you know, please join them, find out what Save Our Sports is all about, and continue to support our student athletes. Okay. Okay, next is our NEASC accreditation site visit. I believe this has been a two-year process that we've gone through. It's here, finally. I know Principal Wolder and her team, we've had her committee chairs of Kathy Ledger from our guidance department, Dan Corbett from our math department, Nicole McLaurin from our English department, and Tracy Chula Montero. And also, I know Jody Nelson, I see her out there. I know there's been a lot of work done with the team from Brockton High School, so they will present to you now, and I believe you're presenting a PowerPoint.
Yes. Good evening. As Superintendent Smith said, this has been a two-year process. 2 years ago, I came before the committee and said, we are going to begin our self-study. It was for 2 years. It led to the development of our core values, beliefs, and expectations statement that we presented to you last year. It has also led to all of the documents. You probably received either a very long email with multiple attachments or in paper version. I don't know how Wanda sent it to you. But there are 7 standards. Each standard had to write a report, an executive summary, identify strengths and weaknesses of the school. We also had to come up with a school and community profile. All of that information was sent to you. You will not have a test on October 5th that says you have to know all all of that information, but it's important to be familiar with the core values, beliefs, and expectations, and be familiar with the strengths and weaknesses identified in the executive summaries, because part of this process involves you. They are looking to speak to the school committee and talk to you about Brockton High School and the facility, and they'll have a number of questions for each of you on the Sunday. So what Kathy Ledger is here to do with me is just to kind of go over some of the things to expect. The visit is in about 2 weeks, October 5 through 8. For you, the visit is October 5th for the most part. For the rest of us, it's the full 3 days that they'll be in the building and around the building, and then on that Wednesday, they have a meeting with the full faculty to pretty much sum up their findings and say, here's what we noticed about your school, here's some suggestions, and then they go off and write a very long report about everything that they saw and what they believe about the school. They send it back to us, and for in 2 years, we have to respond to some of the things, so we have to have a two-year plan and then a five-year plan. So we've already developed plans based on our own findings from our strengths and weaknesses, but they will give us additional information that we'll have to take a look and say, here's some other things that we need to do based on what the NEAS visiting team has told us. They are bringing 22 people with them. We were able, fortunately, to reduce the number of people coming because they were originally bringing between 30 and 35 people. And so they understood that under the circumstances with the budget that we have, for one, that's too many people to bring into the school no matter what. And two, they understood the constraints. And when we talked about the expense of going through this process, because we do have to pay hotel, food, transportation, any materials that they need, we are responsible for paying for all of that, as well as for them to have the reports that they do professionally done. And so it's a huge expense on the school system, but accreditation is a must for our kids in terms of being accepted into colleges. And so the committee chairs, Superintendent Smith already identified, and Jody Nelson has been the editor of most of the information that you've seen, and was instrumental in helping design our core values, beliefs, and expectations, as well as the school and community profile that you received. And we just put this up to give you a reminder of this is the document that we have hanging in every classroom in the school and hanging around the school, because it does identify our beliefs. And this, you normally hear it as a vision and mission statement. NEAS expects you to say what your core values, beliefs, and 21st century expectations are. And so we incorporated what we have done for many years, which is our literacy initiative, as well as from our previous mission statement and the mission statement of the district at the time. And so we also had to do quite a bit of research about what 21st century expectations are, so that we are preparing kids for what they're expected to do once they're out of high school. Some of the things that we were able to accomplish in this past school year, the standards report was ratified by the full faculty. Those are the reports that you have. It's the culminating document of all of the standards. The school and community profile was also accepted by the faculty. And we met with Donald Gainey, who is the chairperson for our visiting team. He was here last week with the assistant chair and went through about probably 50 pages of stuff with us to say, here's what's going to happen when we get here. But ultimately, his hope is that, and as he put it, he wants people to come in and identify the things that are going well in the school. But they also have a responsibility to be honest about areas that need some work. And so part of the visit is them walking the facility, and they will visit every single classroom and see every teacher at teaching. They will interview all of you, and then they will interview the executive team members, and they will interview teachers, students, parents, community members. And so in that amount of time that they're here, they're going to try to at least, they will see every teacher, but they will try to talk to as many people as they possibly can to get a full view, so that as they look at the report and they hear the findings from the people they interview, they'll come up with what it is that they believe is a good representation of Brockton High School. And I'll have Kathy go over the Sunday schedule. Actually, she'll go over all of the schedules, but Sunday is the key day for you, starting at 1 o'clock, and our Sunday is from 1 to 5 on the 5th, and I'll let Kathy go through what that day will look like for everyone.
Thank you, Sharon. Good evening. Just a little bit, you saw the last entry on the last slide. It said housekeeping. That's basically what we've been doing now, is all the minute details of getting ready for the four-day visit. The first day of the visit on Sunday, there'll be a panel presentation. So the school committee members are invited, the chairs from each of the standards, faculty, parents, students are all invited to this presentation. It will involve some presentations from the superintendent, from the principal, from students, and from key members of the school. After that, the visiting team members would like to meet with the school committee, and they have some questions they may be asking you about some of the documents, what your participation in this process were, and any supporting evidence that they might need. After that, one of the first parent panels will meet. And then for the next hour will be teacher interviews. And for every visiting team member, there will be a teacher to interview, and they'll interview two teachers. So they'll be interviewing 42 teachers on Sunday. They'll be going into their classroom, they'll be looking at student work, and they'll be assessing whether we're meeting the standards based on the information in the reports. And then finally on Sunday, we'll have the principal's welcome and reception in the Fine Arts Lobby, and we're hoping to have our students in the culinary program prepare the refreshments, and we'll have some entertainment as well. On Monday, it's probably one of the busiest days of the visit. They'll arrive right after 7 o'clock. They'll be working out of the yellow IRC, and we're told that it's kind of a no-enter zone. It's only for visiting team members. No one can go in there at all during the day. We're organizing small group meetings with students, another parent group in the afternoon with teachers, with administrators, and there'll be several central office staff that will be asking to participate. They want to speak to certain people at central office, so we'll be sending out invites over the next week or so to let you know what your involvement, the central office staff involvement, would be. They're going to shadow students on Monday, and I believe in the afternoon that day as well, and they'll be going to two periods of classes with those students, and they will be having lunch in the cafeteria with students on Monday. There'll also be three different organized tours. One would be with the building and maintenance people, Ken Thompson, and then two student-led tours. And then in the afternoon on Monday, they'll meet with each of the chairs and the committee members for each standard. And that involves every faculty member in the school. They've all been assigned a committee to work on. Tuesday, small group meetings with school administration and clerical support staff. Again, some more student shadowing. And then the rest of that day, they will be collecting evidence and reviewing evidence and student work. Wednesday, they'll be doing the same thing, and then at the end of the day, we have a full faculty meeting where the chairperson, John Ganey, will have some closing remarks. He'll mention a few of our strengths and some areas that they think we need some improvement, and then we'll get a final report, I think, a few months later, but it kind of gives us an idea of where we're at. So, any questions?
We don't know what they're going to ask you. We'd love to tell you. Here's the questions you should prepare yourself for. I could tell.
Discussion.
Mr. Jordan.
Yeah, I have a question. Are they meeting with us as a group,
or are they individually meeting with us?
As a group.
Thank you. Better.
We looked in
Looking
all the guidebooks
for one-on-one, Ozzie?
No, thanks.
We looked in all the guidebooks for any type of support for school committee members on what kinds of questions they would ask, and there was nothing there. So they have some, you know, some support for the teachers, what teachers should have ready for them when they're interviewed, but very little information about exactly what they're going to talk to school committee members about. So it'll be about the reports. It'll be about your general feelings about the school and programs there, I'm sure.
When you mentioned the questions the teachers are going to be asked, can you send a copy of that to us? We'll make sure we give that to the school committee so they can see the types of questions the teachers are answering.
Sure.
Will all 22 be at our meeting?
Yes.
Yes.
It's interesting. That's a large group of people to bring in to do.
It may not be that many. I think that a couple of them might be doing something else. I'll have to look at the numbers.
My thought would be that what our mission is what they're going to ask us. So.
Okay.
Anyone else?
Just so you know, there's a lot of the people on the visiting team. We have several school administrators, and so they probably will ask you a number of questions related to budget. They'll probably ask a number of questions related to your oversight over curriculum. And so we do have guidance counselors, teachers, and we're school administrator heavy for this visiting team. So they will probably be very interested in talking to the school committee.
One of the things we can also make sure we have, our school committee has certainly had, I think, you know, in looking, I know the preparation is different for the NEASC, but we did have, again, a transition. We had an entry plan that we just shared, which really talked about our district. We had a district review. I mean, these are things we can review. We do have these documents, and again, I know you have most of them. I'll make sure that, you know, you have that certainly just at your fingertips for things that you might want to be looking at.
We look forward to having it done.
Yeah.
I want to thank you again, and I think I made it very clear. There has been a lot of hard work for the past 2 years. I know even for a school committee participation, I want to say Mike Healy was the first member. Was Tony Donegan?
Tony was
involved.
The first.
We've had a lot, Mike took over for Tony. There's been a lot of transitioning. Andy, I think you stepped in at one point.
Tom
stepped in.
Yes.
All right, so there's certainly been involvement as we've gone along. I was very, very impressed with the document. I know a lot of hard work went into it, and we know the work and the accolades that go on at Brockton High School, and I think we also can look at ourselves critically. We have certainly done that for the past year, so I think we're well poised to answer questions from the visiting team, and I am really looking forward to the visit. I know the relief will be when the visit is completed and we can move on to implementing our strategic plan and a lot of the other things we need to do in the district. So again, thank you for all the hard work.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, next we have items to refer to subcommittee. We, of course, and I know you've been contacted, we have all kinds of subcommittees coming up. I think the one that we're looking to schedule is the policy subcommittee, and we'll again work with Mr. Robinson to come up with a date. I know there are a number of policies that are kind of on that front burner. Yes, so I know that that's one that we do have a couple of policies. There's fingerprinting, there's a couple of things that we definitely need some direction on and would like to, I think that's the one subcommittee that has not been set yet.
No.
But we have a busy month coming up.
Does anyone have a specific item that they would like to refer to a subcommittee? We have them almost all lined up to meet. I have one item I'd like to ask the committee about. And I spoke to the superintendent about this yesterday. If we can carve out just maybe 15 minutes at the upcoming curriculum subcommittee, I'd like to bring the folks in from school, police, and SROs to talk to you about reinstating the GREAT program in the middle schools, gang resistance education and training. It's been out of the schools for a few years. We've already made an investment in the training. We have 12 officers between school police and SROs that are certified to teach the GREAT program now. And I thought perhaps if they came in and gave you a little overview of the curriculum and the program and exactly how it would work. I'll tell you from my standpoint, I think it's critical. One of the biggest challenges we have in the city is getting young people to not choose a gang lifestyle. Within an hour of when I came here tonight, we arrested an armed robbery suspect from an armed robbery in Stoughton, 15 years old. So if you don't think we've got young people and teenagers involved with guns, you're sadly mistaken. And we have to take this on head on. And I really believe that this is a very worthwhile program. It establishes positive relationships between police officers and young people. And I'm not asking you to make a decision on it now. I'm just asking you to take 15 minutes or so to hear a little bit more detail from the couple of the officers that are certified to teach the class.
Mr. Mayor, but today we went over our subcommittee, so we did try to put aside the 15 minutes.
Okay, that's great.
I know we're
going
to be doing outreach already to Lieutenant Mills. I know Officer Lieberg had done some work with this, so we are carving out that time.
Yeah.
I believe the date is September 24th is our curriculum subcommittee meeting.
Okay, and I spoke with the chief today, too, and they would very much like to get the officers in the middle schools back presenting the GREAT program again. Thank you.
Very good.
Okay. Unfinished business? I don't think we have any, do we? We probably have a lot of it, but none of it we want to talk about right now. So we'll go on to new business. And Mr. Minicello, are you taking the lead on the superintendent's evaluation subcommittee?
Would you like to?
Yeah, as I wasn't there, I'll defer to you.
Okay. The superintendent contract subcommittee met earlier this evening at 6 o'clock. We had an open meeting to the public, and where we basically took a full hour to go over the evaluation of Superintendent Smith. We had a very open and honest discussion with each other. We went through the entire evaluation report, and it basically deals with instructional leadership, management and operations, family and community engagement, professional culture, and it's basically scaled on four items. The scale is unsatisfactory, needs improvement, proficient, or exemplary. And the standards now per DESE are very high. To score proficient is basically excellent, and to score exemplary is like totally off the charts, basically. I mean, it's and needs improvement. People might think that that's a bad score, but it really isn't. It's basically, you know, you can learn more and continue to learn more and get better at your craft, but it doesn't mean you're doing a bad job. But so with that said, the superintendent scored a solid proficient, and a tad higher than proficient, actually. We also, in some categories, it called for basically explanations, and we went through all of the comments section with each other, and I'm just going to read one that I think sort of summarizes the overall feeling of the committee. Superintendent Smith has done a great job fostering a culture of child-centered excellence and has set high expectations for students, teachers, and staff. She has shown collaborative leadership in all elements in the Brockton Public Schools that will enable the district to effect meaningful, sustainable change in the lives of our students. Superintendent Smith has taken a proactive approach to management and has worked to create meaningful assessment tools and accountability systems in order to gauge student achievement, identify areas of opportunity or improvement, and make sound decisions. The superintendent interacts with individuals at all levels in the organization and with the community at large. I feel the superintendent Smith's relationship with the community is one of her strongest attributes. this isn't my comment, this is one of the members. But I think all of us, when we were discussing the superintendent earlier, agree with that, and we find that, especially in this tough budget season, that her earnestness and credibility and ability to communicate, I think, made a very tough situation as good as it can get, basically. You know, we all weren't happy with the finances due to, you know, items out of our control, but I think the superintendent helped chart the course and alleviated a lot of grief that otherwise may have resulted. So overall, the score would amount to a 2% increase with respect to her overall compensation. She consistently jokes with me that the school committee has negotiated a very stingy contract with her, and that that score is basically a it's a tough. She negotiated a very beneficial contract to the city of Brockton, basically, and she generously basically said to us today that she will accept her increase, but that her increase is going to be donated back to the Brockton Education Foundation, which I found, and I think all of us found, very touching and gracious. Basically, I think that's who Kathy Smith is, and it was a very honest and open discussion, and I think you could tell from our meeting that the school committee has full confidence in you going forward. So, anyone else? So I would make a motion to approve the report of the superintendent's contract subcommittee.
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded. All in favor?
And then I need to make a motion to approve the minutes of the superintendent's contract subcommittee.
Second.
All in favor?
Did you want to say anything, Superintendent Smith?
I did, and I did say this in the subcommittee. You know, as far as being a first year as superintendent, it was invigorating, it was exciting. I loved being out there representing the district. I learned a lot of lessons. I believe there's, as you said, there's a lot of room for growth. I'm excited about year two and implementing our strategic plan and continuing to do the hard work in the district. I want to thank, again, everybody that made it a year that I felt was successful. You know, my executive team, my deputy superintendents. I work very closely with the unions, in particular Kim Gibson with the Brockton Education Association. But I think the most important thing that I have to say is we wouldn't have been able to do all of the things that we were able to do if it wasn't for the support of the school committee. I know we had a lot of hard discussions. We had more subcommittee meetings. You told me there was not a year like it. You had seven unions in negotiations. We had reviews and entry plans and transition plans and finally strategic planning. It was just an exhausting year, I think, when we all lifted our heads in the end. So I want to thank you for the continued support, because I think it makes a difference in a school system when we don't always agree, but we're able to work together and do that hard work together. So I want to thank you for doing that this past year.
Thank you, Superintendent.
Okay.
Everybody good?
Okay. So continuing on under new business, we need to elect a voting delegate to the MASC annual business meeting. So, Tom, nominations? Do we have anyone nominated?
Well, basically, we need to establish who's going, first of all.
Yeah. We'd like to limit the nominations to people who are actually
attending.
We want to
figure out who's going.
The MASC meeting, yeah.
So do we know who's going? I know I'm going to be going. I'm not going to be there the whole time, but I'll be picking
dates
and choosing. The beginning of November. Are you going? Okay. Andy, are you going?
I am. Looking at the agenda, though, I probably won't be there for the voting. There's basically one designated piece where we need to.
Okay. All right. I mean, so if you'd like, I'll plan to be there for that. If not, if Ozzy, you'd like to do it, by all means, whatever.
Play in the meeting.
Okay. Why don't we nominate Mr. Jordan?
Okay.
And he'll carry the torch for the Brockton Public Schools. So I'll make a motion.
Is that a motion, Mr.
I'll make a motion to nominate Ozzy Jordan as our voting delegate at the MASC annual business meeting.
I'll second that.
Okay. All in favor? Mr. Jordan, congratulations. You're elected. Once again, we got the new guy to do it.
Yeah.
I'll make a motion to nominate myself as the alternate.
Supposed to let Ozzy nominate
you.
It's supposed to be a reciprocal thing. All right. We've got a motion on the floor to nominate Mr. Minicello as the alternate in case Mr. Jordan, for some unknown reason, God forbid, is unable to serve. All in favor? Mr. Minicello, you're the alternate.
Thank you.
And Mr. Jordan, thank you for your service. MOU?
Yes.
Okay, go right ahead.
Okay, we have some important news with respect to a memorandum of agreement between the Brockton School Committee and the Brockton School Custodian Association. The association and the school committee have been meeting for several months, close to a year. And one of the big issues that we had to address was obviously the crossing guard situation. And we, at the last meeting, came up with a memorandum of agreement. I would like to personally compliment John Talbot and his negotiating team for basically stepping up and making and bargaining in good faith and making a decision in the best interest of the of their union as well as in the best interest of the students in our district. Basically, I'll summarize the agreement, and that is that the crossing guard pay previously was at an overtime rate, time and a half, and we were able to negotiate a flat rate in the neighborhood of $25, where previously the rates ranged from approximately $34 to $47, $48, something like that. So we negotiated some items with respect to the maintenance craftsmen. They no longer are going to be doing crossing guard duty. However, there is a provision that gives them a step compensation, not as lucrative as they previously were able to if they so chose, but again, a good faith effort, and again allows us as a district to have more bodies on the street helping our children for basically the same amount of money as we previously were paying for 72. Now we're able to have 92 plus 8 floaters out there, so basically 100 personnel. I'd like to personally thank the team on our side. No longer Alicia Clark, now Alicia Wilson. We need to fix this plaque. And Mr. Henningsen, I'd like to also thank Lisa Martineau of Human Resources, our counsel, Kevin Bresnahan, the support we received through Mr. Thompson and Mr. Thomas, and our mayor's participated, and some people on the city side, Mr. Condon, Mr. Petronio. So it was a good effort. It was a good agreement. It's an MOU, so we don't have to have a full vote of the association. But Mr. Talbot, basically, like I said, his team stepped up and did a really good thing. So that is the summary of this agreement. So I would like to make a motion for the school committee to basically approve the contents of this agreement so we can go forward officially. We are sort of in an unofficial status, but the custodians have basically stepped up and started under the terms in good faith. So we need to approve it so that we can go forward and basically get more for less, so to speak.
Motion to approve the MOU.
Yeah, and I think, Tom, just for the record, that the school committee members were all provided with a copy of the MOU that they've had a chance to review.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we've got a motion on the floor to approve the MOU. Second is made. All in favor? Approved unanimously. And thank you.
Thank you, John.
Yep. And I would just like to echo some of Tom's sentiments, that just that John Talbot and his negotiating team for the union, and Tom's leadership and the negotiating team, and the support from the executive team. It was, they've been doing a lot of work for a long time, but when it came down to the wire, I think both sides really put the interest of the students, the safety of the students first, and there was some compromise on both sides, and I guess that's how you usually get a deal done. But I know that when I went out yesterday morning and saw 100 crossing guards back on duty, I feel a lot better, particularly with the first day of kindergarten. And I think, you know, we should acknowledge the fact that the members of the union have been doing a really good job at this for a long time, and that was one of the advantages to us being able to come to a new agreement, was so that we could keep good people on the job, keeping the kids safe. So I just want to thank the folks on both sides, and also, as Tom mentioned, thank the union for the good faith of returning to the positions immediately yesterday while we get this ratified on both sides. So thank you very much, and Tom, thank you for your leadership. Okay. Anyone else? Okay. So on to new business. Any other new business? No? Anything else, Superintendent?
The only thing I'd like to remind people is Kyle Landerholm spoke to me the other day. I know Jocelyn Meek sent word out to everybody that there is a grand reopening of the Brockton Historical Society. I believe it's this Sunday, the 21st of September, from 1 to 5. There are new rooms. There's new update in the interior. He's very excited about, you know, continuing to offer this to the residents to come to the museum, bring families, and come and see the new exhibits at the Brockton Historical Society. So if you have an opportunity Sunday, everyone is welcome to attend.
Absolutely. I'm planning to go. Anything else? Seeing no other new business, I'll entertain a motion.
Second.
Motion to adjourn made and seconded. All in favor? This meeting is adjourned.